wonderful introduction.
And I'm very inspired by your words, actually. It's my great pleasure to be here in Bhubaneswar for the first time, actually. Let me go back to my first slide. My first visit, I want to thank Mr. Subrata Bakshi for making this possible. It really is a delightful experience. You know, in many ways, this story of what's happening in Orissa, what has been happening, I read the Chief Minister's speech from a week or two ago, is a bit of a well-kept secret. I think there's a lot of positive things that are happening here in this society and in this state, which a lot of people don't know about. There's a lot of cynicism out there, everybody thinks everything is going to hell. But the fact is, there are positive stories all over the world. And we need to highlight stories where the government is effective in spreading flourishing and alleviating poverty, but as the Secretary said, going beyond that bare minimum. So again, I do think that it's a story that should be more broadly known around the world. What we're going to talk about here today for the next hour or so, this idea of flourishing embedded within the notion of conscious capitalism, but again, what is the purpose of business, what is the purpose of government, what is the purpose of any entity in society, or even us as individuals? At some macro level, it's really about flourishing, it's really about healing, it's about spreading well-being on the planet. Right? So if you think about what that means, how do we build a conscious society? A society in which everybody achieves or has the opportunity to realize their extraordinary potential as human beings. And for that, it's not just government that has to play a role. But it's government along with business, along with civil society, non-profits, the education sector, etc., all of us who have to work together in order to create this ideal society, conscious society. There is a specific role. These are the three legs of the stool for society. And there's a specific role for each of them to play. And there are many areas in which we need cooperation between business, government, or government and non-profits, or all three of the sectors are working together. But the common element really is higher consciousness. We have to approach everything that we do with a level of purpose, right, with a sense of service. And it's interesting if you think about the role of government in that regard. Remember, the civil service was created by the British in colonial days, not as a way to serve the people, but really as a way to control the people, to control the natives. Right? And that's essentially why the system was created. Its purpose was that. And then after independence, when we transformed it to the IAS and so forth, that mindset to a degree remained. And I think it's slowly starting to change to one of service. Government and the civil service exist in order to serve the people, not to control them. And I think that mentality, you know, that connects now to a higher purpose of what it's about. So I think we're getting there. We're all on the journey of rising consciousness. And we're going to focus today on the business sector, what we have to do in that sector. And in summary, what I would say is that it is time for the business sector really to wake up, to grow up, and to show up. What do we mean by that? Wake up means to become more conscious, to recognize our importance and also our responsibility. Even though it's private enterprise, there is a public aspect to our responsibility. It's not just about private gain at public expense. It's really about elevating society. So to wake up to our higher capacities and our higher potential, but also our higher calling and responsibility to grow up and to show up, to be part of the larger challenges that we all face, to be part of the solution and not part of the problem. So let's talk about this idea of waking up. I'd like to use this analogy of a caterpillar and a butterfly. Think about the two levels of existence. It's the same creature, same DNA. Right? But when you first see a caterpillar when you're a child, all it's doing is eating pretty much. And that's all the caterpillar does. It's a little consumer. It just eats everything in its path. But then a few weeks later, it enters this phase of transformation. Right? It's the metamorphosis, the imaginal cells are switched on. And it emerges a few weeks later as a very different creature. A creature of light and beauty, certainly one of the most beautiful things nature has, but also an element or an instrument of flourishing, because without butterflies and the cross-pollination that they do, other forms of life would not be able to flourish. So here's a creature that is now showing us, it's a metaphor for us. You say, you can exist at a caterpillar level. I know many human beings who are 50 years old who are still living like caterpillars. It's all about consumption, it's all about material, it's all about me. But most of us are on a journey of rising consciousness, and we too can become instruments of light and beauty and service. Think about all the great leaders, where they started from and who they ended up. Think about Gandhiji. From a corporate lawyer in South Africa to a world-changing figure. That was his transformation, his elevation of consciousness, his awakening. But the same also applies to anything that we create as human beings. Any kind of organization that we create also can exist at different levels. If you think about the business world, what do we say? The narrow view of business. The Milton Friedman view of business, the business only exists to maximize its own profits and stay within the law. Well, that is saying that the business must be a caterpillar forever, simply taking in natural resources, human resources so-called, and I don't like that phrase, I'll come back to that, financial resources and generating profits for the owners. That's a caterpillar way of being. But corporations and organizations also can elevate their consciousness, and they too can become entities of light and beauty and flourishing. That's really what this journey is about. Just like human beings have a journey in our lifetime, so do organizations, and they can exist at a higher plane. Now, before we talk about capitalism, or conscious capitalism, it is actually important to also talk about, okay, this is not very responsive. Am I supposed to be pointing at any particular place? Oh, it's kind of okay. So let's talk about capitalism itself. Now this is considered a bad word in many places, maybe even here. Probably is. We're in the eastern part of India. Capitalism is, again, a word coined by a critic, Karl Marx, right? And seen as a system of exploitation inherently. But I would argue that that is not the reality of what is capitalism, what we call capitalism. And before we talk about that, let's look at the economic history of the world for the last 2,000 or so years. We have reasonably good ways of estimating per capita incomes, adjusted for inflation. And you can see that in the year 0, it was $477 per person. And in the year 1,000, it was $453 per person. In 1,000 years, we actually went backwards. Can you imagine that? For India, if you fall below 6% right now, it's a crisis, right? In 1 year, this is 1,000 years of negative. And that too, at what level? $450 on a global basis means that 90 to 95% of people live on the equivalent of less than $1 a day in today's terms. The World Bank defines abject poverty as $1.25. That was the default condition of humanity. Most people lived lives of extreme poverty, short lives. 28 to 30 years was the life expectancy. A tiny fraction of people had better lives. And that was something they were born into, the landed gentry, the aristocracy. Everybody else was confined by the circumstances of their birth. So think about, so the first 1,000 years, nothing happened. You know, dark ages, then we enter into middle ages, and we started to see signs of awakening. Humanity was waking up. So in the 15th century, we had the Renaissance starting in Europe and Italy, art and literature and music. These are higher level human capacities. We also had the creation of printing, the invention of printing press by Gutenberg in Germany. So these were significant breakthroughs for humanity. But they had no impact on ordinary lives. 90% of people were illiterate, could not read. So the fact that books were a little more affordable didn't really matter. And again, most people had no opportunity to go and enjoy art or literature or music. They were just trying to stay alive. You go another 200 years, in the 17th century we had the age of science and enlightenment. We had Isaac Newton. with the laws of physics and inventive calculus. And we had Joseph Galileo looking at our place in the universe. Again, extraordinary breakthroughs for humanity, no impact on ordinary human beings. What finally did change was in the 18th century, when a few things came together in a short period of time, starting with the Industrial Revolution, roughly around 1750, in the tiny country of Scotland, the Industrial Revolution started. Now, this was a major technological breakthrough, perhaps the biggest single technological leap that humankind has ever made. Because suddenly now we have our productive capacity went up dramatically. We could produce a lot more at consistent quality and lower cost than ever before. And those countries that had access to this new technology saw their prosperity rise. So again, a huge technological breakthrough. But that wasn't enough. We also needed a breakthrough in thinking. And that came a quarter century later in 1776, also in Scotland. So tiny little Scotland turns out to have made a lot of contributions. In this case, it was Adam Smith, who was a moral philosopher, not an economist. There were no economists in those days. So Adam Smith wrote what is now considered the foundational text for understanding the power of markets. It's called An Inquiry into the Nature and Causes of the Wealth of Nations. Just known as Wealth of Nations in short. But his question was very simple. He said, why is it that some places are prosperous and other places remain stuck in poverty? Most people would have said, well, of course, it has to do with natural resources. Some places are just endowed with great natural resources. He found that wasn't the case. Natural resources do not explain prosperity. Others would have said it has to do with the culture, the work ethic. Some places people are just much harder working, more organized, more entrepreneurial. Again, he found that wasn't the case. Very similar cultures, very different outcomes. What he found ultimately was that it had to do with the amount of freedom that ordinary people enjoyed. Societies in which ordinary human beings were free to pursue their own passions and develop their own talents and share the fruits of that work with others, where they are allowed to produce and trade without any restrictions or very few restrictions. And in those societies, ordinary individuals would end up meeting the needs of other individuals. And that would happen much more efficiently and effectively than a system of centralized planning, where you have some bureaucrats or a monarch figuring out how much do we need of this commodity or that commodity and who should produce it and what should be the price. Central planning in that sense does not work. Enabling, giving people the freedom to make those decisions eventually ends up meeting most of the needs. There's still a need for governments and nonprofits to fill in certain gaps, but most of the needs can be met by people and can be met more efficiently and effectively, and that causes a rise in prosperity. So this was a major intellectual breakthrough, the idea of the invisible hand of the market as a very powerful mechanism for allocating efforts as well as setting prices. Major intellectual breakthrough. Now that same year, 1776, was also the birth of the United States. The Declaration of Independence was issued on July 4th of 1776. And if you haven't read it, I would urge you to look it up, because it's one of the most inspiring documents any human being has ever written. Because it really captures fundamentally human aspirations towards freedom. That human beings are born to be free, we are meant to be free. We are endowed with certain inalienable rights. Those rights do not come from government, they come from God, nature, whatever you want to call it. Okay, human beings are intended to be free and to exercise that freedom and to live in freedom. And those ideas were in the DNA of the United States, which is a unique country. No country on this planet has ever existed on the basis of a set of ideas. The United States came into being because a bunch of people believed a common set of values, and those values revolve around freedom. Religious freedom, political freedom, and economic freedom. The ordinary person was in charge of their own destiny by right of law. You could rise from nothing to great heights. You did not have to be born into privilege. So the combination of these three things, the technological breakthrough, the intellectual breakthrough, and the oxygen of freedom, enabled humanity to wake up and to take off. You can look at the data here. In purely economic terms, per capita incomes have risen 1,500% in real terms in 200 years, after being flatlined for millennia before that. In fact, in the more industrialized nations, developed countries, they have risen about 100-fold. And not only economically, but again, other human indicators as well, literacy has gone from 10% to close to 90%. Our population reached 1 billion in 1820, now it's 7.3 billion. Life expectancy has gone from 28 to 71 in this time period. Almost every indicator of human well-being has shot up dramatically in these last 200 years, coincident with the spread of this idea of free markets and free people. There is a strong correlation between the kinds of systems that we have put into place to operate as societies and the amount of progress that society has made. Now, there is a belief that this is a system that inherently is rooted in exploitation. And some people get extraordinarily wealthy and other people remain stuck. Well, the data does not support that. If you look at the percentage of people living in poverty, it's down from 90% to the low teens. And in fact, in the next 20, 30 years, we will eradicate extreme poverty. India is a great example. Starting in 1991, the Indian growth story started with the opening up and bringing more market forces and reducing regulation and pulling back on the role of the public sector. India has been a dramatic story. The explosive growth in the middle class. And even today, 250,000 people every single day are being lifted out of extreme poverty. And we will eradicate extreme poverty in our lifetime. In the next 20, 30 years, we are, you know, the UN Millennium Goals. We are actually ahead of projections. Muhammad Yunus has said someday we should be required to go to a museum to see what extreme poverty looks like. Because we should be able to eliminate that. That's why we eradicated certain diseases from this planet. We should be able to eradicate extreme poverty. It's an unnatural human condition. Human beings are meant to be free, and human beings are also meant to live in relative prosperity. So in that sense, I would argue that the key issue around the world is not the unequal distribution of income, but the unequal distribution of freedom. If we spread freedom, prosperity will follow. And income disparities will also go down, but it's important to have the bottom brought up, rather than worrying so much about what's happening at the top. So that's the positive story about business and capitalism. And it's a real story. And I would argue that business needs to be understood and appreciated because it is the instrument of human advancement. But at the same time, there's been a certain consciousness with which business has been done. And there have been consequences of that. So if you look at the last 100 years, what has happened? A lot of the natural forests are gone. Now, I'm sure that Orissa is actually, again, a positive example where there's high forest cover. Perhaps unique. I was in Costa Rica, where they've taken their forest cover from 21 back up to 51%. So there are examples, but the natural, the ancient, the old forests are gone. We can replace them with newer forests. A lot of the arable land is now becoming unusable, partly because of deforestation as well. Large mammals are down 90% in the last 100 years. The oceans are emptying out of the large fish. 95% decline in the last 100 years. Half the species that are alive today are likely to disappear in the next 50 years. These are some of the consequences of the way in which we have achieved. Also, if you look at the toxic burden on human beings, that has been growing. So, for example, in the US, the President's Commission on Cancer issued a report a few years ago that that 42% of Americans who are alive today can expect to get cancer in their lifetime. That includes 50% of men and 33% of women. Now that number was only 25% in the Reagan administration. So in the 80s it was 25%, now it's 42%. Rapid rise in cancer, but also diabetes, heart disease, obesity. You know, there are many indicators that as we're living longer, our health is not improving. We're spending decades being sick. So there's something that's happening as a consequence of the way in which we've achieved our prosperity. And this is not even including all of the psychological consequences. The amount of extraordinary stress that people are under through their work. Right? So there's been a price to pay because of the way in which we have done business. So we need to think about why that is. You can see that the confidence that people have in business has actually been going down. Even in the United States, which you would think would be a very business-friendly place, the fact is that only about 20% of Americans trust big business. 80% of Americans do not trust public companies, large companies. There's a huge amount of cynicism and distrust. And that has a lot of societal costs. When people are cynical and distrustful, they cannot be innovative, they cannot be creative. Your body physically shuts down your capacity to be innovative. You're operating in survival mode. And most people are operating in that cynical, distrustful, fear-based survival mode. The fact is, we're going to need tremendous innovation in the next 100 years. There's nothing that we will be able to do in the next 100 years the same way that we did in the last 100 years. We have to reinvent just about everything. Our energy, our transportation, our food, our housing, our clothing, everything has to be rethought. And those innovations have to come from human beings. And most human beings are not in a place where they actually are engaged and are able to be creative and innovative. So there's something fundamentally misaligned here. The question I ask is, where did we go wrong? We have this extraordinary institution rooted in freedom, which we call capitalism or free markets. And somehow we have so many negative consequences while we are creating financial wealth. I would argue that the single biggest problem has been this philosophy of profit maximization. The idea that businesses exist for one reason and one reason alone, and that is to maximize profits for their shareholders. It's an extraordinarily narrow way of thinking. It is also a very selfish way of thinking. It's only about me. How can I use other people, treat them as objects for your success, not caring about their lives? And it's instrumental. So it's selfish, instrumental, and narrow way of thinking. The fact is, businesses have many, many impacts on our lives. And if a business is run with only the motive to make money, that means everybody else will be treated as a means to that end, which means their well-being will not matter. Which means that eventually that's what's going to lead to exploitation and suffering. Think about it. Why did the world ever come up with socialism, communism, Marxism? It was all in response to unconscious capitalism. Unconscious capitalism created socialism. It started by creating trade unions. Military trade unions. Why? Because workers were very, very poorly treated in the 19th century. Just look at Carnegie Steel. They decided to go from 5 days to 6 days a week, from 10 hours a day to 12 hours a day, and they cut pay at the same time, all at once, to make more money. 10% of the workforce was dying every year from exhaustion. Imagine working in a steel plant for 12 hours, every day, 6 days. And when they started protesting, instead of listening to them and seeing how the world can be made safer and more doable, they hired a private army called the Pinkertons. Basically shoot them down. This was in the 1880s. The Pinkertons was a private army in the US that had more men and more guns than the US Army. It was available for hire by companies as a way of controlling their workers. Let's think about it. So that mentality gave rise to militant trade unions, which then created the conditions where the philosophies around socialism, Marxism, and communism flourished. So we have to get rid of this dehumanized and toxic way of thinking about business. And there are several different aspects to this. First of all, a lot of people have come to believe that business is just like a machine. This is a relic of the industrial age and also the value of scientific management and so forth that get tailored. You know, that we can treat it with inputs and outputs. Yeah, just put in human resources, natural, you know, you get products and you get people. It's like a machine. It's dehumanized, but it's not. Business is not a machine. Some people treat it like a game. Some CEOs tell us, you take this too seriously. You know, you face death, some you win, some you lose. You move on. Well, there are real human consequences to those bets. So it's not a game. There's much more at stake. Some people treat business like a math problem. My academic colleagues, it's all a math problem. If you become an economics general, it's basically higher math. And while, of course, math can be used very powerfully, for many people it just becomes about that. They lose sight. You know, we've made it into an optimization, maximize profit subject to all of this. But that works to create elegant mathematical models of reality. That's not reality. Business is not a math problem. The most toxic metaphor, of course, is that of warfare. Think about it, the language and the mentality of business really came from the military. Within the 19th century, when we started having large corporations, and people were trying to figure out how do we organize, how do we manage, how do we lead, the only models that existed of large organizations were armies. And so the command and control, the hierarchy, the command, the general at the top, the foot soldiers at the bottom, all of that came from the military. The language of strategy and tactics and operations, these are actually military terms. We talk about strategic weapons and tactical weapons. We talk about capturing market share. We treat competitors like the enemy, customers as territory to be captured. Even words like firing comes from the firing squad. Right? So that mindset is very deeply entrenched and also has to do with the masculine aspect of human beings, which has been dominant in this. I'll come back to that idea. Business is not war. War is at best a win-lose game. In fact, in reality, it's a lose-lose game. There are no real winners. Every war, every battle plants the seeds for the next battle. You know, in Europe, they had 1,200 wars in 600 years between European nations until 1946. 1,200 wars in 600 years. Okay? Business is the ultimate win-win game if you do it right. These are not the right metaphors. So what is business? It is about the real lives of real people. As Calvin Coolidge said before the Great Depression on the US president, the business of America is business. That's kind of a narrow way. Business of America is business. It means it's all about making money. This is Herb Kelleher, who's one of the best CEOs in the United States. He built a company called Southwest Airlines into the most successful airline in the history of the world. And the stock market symbol of Southwest Airlines is love, L-U-V. This is a company truly built on love. And as he says, the business of business is people, yesterday, today, and tomorrow. We have lost sight of that. People have to be at the center of everything that we do. Not profit, not some other objective. It's ultimately about the flourishing of people. Everything else, including profit, is a means to that end. And that's what we must say. We have to restore the human being at the center. Human dignity, human well-being, human flourishing above all. So the philosophy of profit maximization was one big reason. But there's also another set of reasons, which is that the world has changed dramatically. So the way of doing business, the narrow way, right, which we thought was working, really wasn't working that well. But it seemed to be working, but now even that doesn't work anymore. Why? Because the world has changed dramatically. We have gone through tectonic shifts in the last quarter century, within our lifetimes for everybody in this room. And we human beings are changing rapidly. Human beings are evolving at a fast and a rapid rate. Things are happening in a decade that used to take thousands of years with us as human beings. The reality is businesses haven't adapted. It's like we're using an operating system that was developed during the industrial age using the military as the organizing metaphor. That operating system is at least 150 years out of date. You have to replace the operating system of business. So what has changed? I mentioned 1776 as a pretty significant year in human history. I would say 1989, maybe even more significant ultimately. Now that's not so long ago. Do you remember 1989? Anybody remember the headline story? Berlin Wall? What happened to it? Came down? It was brought down? Remember, this was a symbol of the defining debate of the 20th century between competing ideologies of how do you organize human society. We had democracy, freedom, capitalism as one model. And then we had socialism, Marxism, communism, government ownership and control of every aspect of your life as the other extreme. The whole world was expected to line up one side or the other. You're with us or you're against us. India was part of the non-aligned segment, right? But really, if you talk about India, well, certainly much more on the socialist end. Nobody thought that this would end well. Remember, we lived under the threat of mutually assured destruction, mad. The US and the Soviet Union had the capacity to destroy each other and the planet 70 times. We thought this would end with a nuclear holocaust, and a nuclear winter to follow. Suddenly, with a gunshot being fired in November of 89, that debate seemed to be over. The human craving and aspiration and right towards freedom prevailed. Half the world was living in a form of slavery. But that was November. In June of that year, we had these scenes from Tiananmen Square. The kids in China standing up to the People's Army. Now that did not end well. Those kids, hundreds of them, were killed eventually. Something that has been erased from the history books of people in China. It didn't happen. I watched it live. Many of us may remember this. In fact, my son was being born at that exact moment, our first child. And that inspired other change around the world. So I mean, a huge turning point in human history. Fukuyama wrote a book called The End of History, describing this as a major chapter in human history. Now, suddenly, we're moving on, where some form of liberal democracy seems to be the best way to organize human society, with political freedom and economic freedom. Now, we can talk about what kind, you know, and what shape that takes, but it has to be rooted in freedom. That's the fundamental conclusion that people have reached. What else happened that year? 1989 was also the year we had something called the Exxon Valdez oil spill in Alaska, which was a big environmental disaster, with oil spilling out into the Alaska Bay. And it was not a unique disaster, but this one actually impacted a lot of people. People were deeply touched by this and became more active and more conscious of the environment as a result. The awakening of environmental consciousness also, you might say, happened that year. It was also the year of the fatwa being issued against Salman Rushdie by Ayatollah Khomeini in Iran for the book the Satanic Verses, which was deemed blasphemous to Islam. And as a result, he went into hiding, 10 people were killed. You know, and this idea of religious fundamentalism has become a fracture now on the global stage. After a couple of relatively secular centuries, you know, human beings used to fight religious wars for a long time. But then we went into a period of more secular conflict. But now, as you know, we've seen a rise of not only Islamic fundamentalism, Hindu fundamentalism, Christian fundamentalism, even I'm told Buddhist fundamentalism is on the rise. Right? But there's something happening. We're stepping into a vacuum, the end of economic fundamentalism, and now another kind of fundamentalism. Some people need something to believe in without asking. So that's a lot of change in 1989, but that's not all. There's also been a quiet demographic revolution that's been brewing. Since the 1970s, most human societies have been getting older. Why? Because birth rates have been falling. It's a consequence of a number of things, including the birth control pill that was invented around then, but also urbanization, industrialization, rising incomes, all of these tend to suppress the fertility rate. And if you look at the consequences of that, in 1989, in the United States, for the first time, there were more adults over the age of 40 than below. So fewer babies and people are living longer. The combination of that means the median age keeps rising. So we have more adults over 40 than below. Now why is 40 significant? It marks what we call midlife. Typical human life is 80 years. 40 is midlife. You've heard of the midlife crisis. Maybe it doesn't happen in India. In America, it's a big deal. People go through a midlife crisis. But what is the crisis? The crisis of meaning and purpose. People start asking, what is the meaning of my life? I thought it was all about the job and the income and the house and the car and the dog and, you know, all of that. Material well-being. And roughly around this time, people say, well, I feel empty. I've achieved a lot of that and still I don't feel satisfied. Is that the rest of life is more of the same? People start thinking about what is the purpose of my life. They start volunteering for causes. They start setting up foundations and nonprofits. There's a hunger for meaning and purpose for my life to mean something. The number one best-selling book of the last 40 years is called The Purpose-Driven Life by Rick Warren. And it's about this hunger that people have. It has nothing to do with self-interest. Economists will tell you that human beings can be defined by their self-interest. Everything we do is because of self-interest. Well, there are people doing things that have nothing to do with their self-interest. But it feeds them as human beings. They want to make a difference. There's a human need to care, which is as powerful as our drive for self-interest. We left that out of this whole capitalism way of thinking. Human need to care and also to have a sense of purpose. So again, this is a global phenomenon. You know, in India, when I was growing up in the 70s, the birth rate, I'm like six, was about six. Remember, we had the all the family planning. Now the Indian birth rate is, I believe, below 2.5. And in the urban areas, it's below 2, which is the replacement rate is 2.1. And sometime in the next 20 years, India's population growth rate will actually slow down and will start going into a negative pattern. Birth rate will fall below replacement. So this is happening everywhere, all over the world. At least 100 countries have a birth rate below replacement. It's not about the population explosion now, it's really a question in many countries of the population implosion. What's going to happen to Japan? What's going to happen to Italy? Very few babies and people living forever. Most societies are aging dramatically. It's a huge issue for social security and safety net and all those kinds of issues that we have to deal with. Okay, we're still in 1989, so this man invented something that year that changed the lives of everybody in this room, I can safely say, and almost everybody on this planet. And yet, most people have no idea who this is. 1989, who is he and what did he invent? His name is Tim Berners-Lee, and he invented the World Wide Web. Is it a fair thing to say that this changed the lives of more people on this planet than any other single invention? Would you agree? Because of this, the ordinary person today has access to more information instantaneously, at their fingertips, anytime, any place, for free, on any subject, than the richest billionaire in the world did 20 years ago. As we say in Washington now, that is a true fact. Okay? See, now we have true facts, and we have facts, and recently we also have alternative facts. I don't know how much you're getting here from the Trump world. True fact. Okay. I had a question the other day, and my daughter looked it up in like half a second, right? You can do that, right? And she asked me, Dad, what did you guys do in the old days? Do you remember the old days? I had to really think as a matter of question. I don't know, you just lived with it, right? You went to a library perhaps, you picked up an obsolete encyclopedia somewhere, probably didn't have anything to call. Or we lived in blissful ignorance, okay? And today there's no such thing. If you want to know something, it's there. It's a very different world. We are extraordinarily informed. Way more than ever before, which means that we're living in transparency. Anything happening anywhere can be known to anybody. In any government, in any corporation, we have no secrets. If you don't want to see it on the front page of the paper, don't do it. Okay? Massive transparency in the world. It's also extraordinarily more connected now. Think about this. Here's another true fact. In 1995, half the people on this planet had never made or received a single phone call in their entire lifetime. And India was a big part of that. Tele density here was 1 in 100. It used to take 14 years when I was growing up to get a phone. It was a 14-year wait. Now if it takes 14 minutes, you would be upset. It's like, what's taking so long? Now they have more phone numbers on this planet than there are people, active phone numbers. And social media has exploded, right? Facebook is up to 2 billion now. We are connected in a way we've never been connected before, which means that we can actually share information and act on that information. Like we have one shared central nervous system. Anything happening anywhere can be known and acted upon. Energies can coalesce around things people care about. You can have Arab Springs and women's marches and all kinds of things that spring up seemingly out of nowhere because there is this underlying connectivity that exists. This one is a little less well known. We are becoming extraordinarily more intelligent. Human beings are becoming smarter. Most people would say that it doesn't feel like that. It looks like they're getting dumber. No. James Flynn looked at the IQ data for the last 80 years. It gets standardized to 100 every 10 years. So the average IQ is always 100 by definition. But if you look at the raw data as he did, he found an underlying trend of 3 to 4% increase every decade for 8 decades. Now if you do the math on that, compound a 3.5% increase over 8 decades, the average person today would have tested at 134 IQ in 1937. That would put them in the top 2% of intelligence. Think about that. The average person today would be smarter than 98% of people in the year 1937. Is that extraordinary? I mean, that's amazing. In one lifetime for us to go that far. It's incredible. People are smart. Ordinary people are highly intelligent. They are capable of extraordinary things. Well, it's one thing if you have intelligence, but if you don't have education, all that intelligence, so I think all the work that you're doing should go to ways of unlocking that potential. People have it. Right? The capacity is there. We need to unlock it by creating the conditions, including education. So if you're really smart, but you don't have education, that remains untapped potential for the most part, right? But the spread of education also is a huge story. 100 years ago, only 90% of Americans finished high school. Today it's 90%. And of those who finished, maybe 25% or less went to college. Today it's about 60%. In South Korea, 75% go to college now. And of those who went to college, only 20% were women. Today it's almost 60% of college students in the United States and other developed countries are women. And the women who did go to college used to go to teaching and nursing and a few other women's fields. And today you see women across disciplines. They outnumber men in almost every professional school, law schools, medical schools, even business schools. Now, my university first admitted a female majority class last year for the first time. And this year we're up to 52% women. This is going to change the world. The single biggest factor I'm going to talk about. Women outnumber men in college everywhere on this planet except here in South Asia and in Sub-Saharan Africa. Everywhere else, even in Saudi Arabia and Iran and Iraq, there are more women in college than there are men. Which means every white-collar profession will be numerically dominated by women. And women will rise to positions of leadership and power. And fundamentally with that is going to come a change in societal values. We are going to see the rise of feminine values in a huge way. Because remember, all of us have masculine and feminine values. But the world has been run by men on a limited set of masculine values. Everything in the world has been characterized by domination, aggression, ambition, competition, winning, results at all costs, sort of a win-lose mentality. We're starting to see the rise of compassion, nurturing, caring, empathy, inclusiveness, win-win, relationships, trust, vulnerability. These are more feminine values. Again, men and women have them, but they have been suppressed in men and women. Women have been kept down, and also the feminine values have been kept down. And that is starting to change. We're starting to recognize the power of so-called feminine values. In fact, a lot of research coming out of this. For example, there's a book called The Athena Doctrine, 60,000 interviews asking what is masculine, what is feminine, and also what is good leadership and what is poor leadership, and correlating the two. And you can't really read the specifics on this, but just look at the colors. The pink are considered the feminine values. You can see a strong correlation between good leadership and feminine values. Good leaders today are those who actually can offer empathy, nurturing, compassion, caring, listening. Leadership is correlated with those values, but so is ethics and morality correlated with feminine values, and happiness as well. It's a very important message for the men and women in this room. We have to cultivate and nurture, in many cases awaken, the feminine side in us which has been suppressed since you were little. As a little boy, you're told, don't show emotion, be a man. That's a deeply damaging thing to do. We have to be full human beings. Think about it, 20 years ago there were no women in leadership in businesses. Now in the US there's one woman running, and there used to be one woman running a Fortune 500 company, now there are 25 women, right? Including IBM and General Motors and DuPont, and of course Indra Nooyi running PepsiCo, and a bunch of others, right? The rate of change is very, very high. The only women we found in leadership and in politics, we had Margaret Thatcher, who was known as the Iron Lady. We had Golda Meir, the original Iron Lady in Israel. Tougher than the toughest men, we had Indira Gandhi here. You know, I came of age in the 70s, Indira Gandhi, the emergency. She was known as the only man in her cabinet. You remember that place? Why? She was tougher than the toughest men. That's how women had to survive. More aggressive, more ruthless, all of that. Unfortunately, that was the reality then, it's not the reality today. What we're discovering is men and women are far better leaders when they integrate masculine and feminine in themselves. Now, I think we have a beautiful symbol of that in this country. We have a lot to teach the world in this regard when it comes to the consciousness side. The earth and the Ishwar, we are born with different genders, but our journey is towards wholeness. Combining the beautiful masculine with the beautiful feminine. Mature masculine. Remember, it's not all about domination and aggression, it's also about strength and courage and discernment and focus and resilience and stillness and nurturing, caring, compassion, beauty, grace. Can we embody that all in one being? This is actually my most recent book called Shakti Leadership. My co-author actually is from Orissa. Nima's based in Mumbai now, but I think her last name is Sakai, actually. But anyway, this book actually brings that idea in, Shakti as a divine feminine force. How do we tap into that as a creative life-giving energy? I'm going to go about 15 more minutes, is that okay? Who's this?
Fine.
Yeah, that's fine? Okay. So, the last element of change here, we've been talking about everything that's been changing, right? The last element, I would say, we're getting more conscious. We are becoming more conscious. Our entire journey on this planet is one of gradually waking up to our own potential, our own reality as divine beings. Unfortunately, for almost all of recorded time, human beings lived almost an animalistic existence. It was only about survival, finding enough food to stay alive. All we could think about was tomorrow, staying alive. But now, more and more of us can take off those blinders. We can see the bigger picture. We can think about future, the future. We can think about the consequences of what I'm doing today on my own life and also on other people and on the planet. As we become aware of those consequences, we also have a greater commitment to making sure that we are not harming others. We have a finer sense of right and wrong. That which was acceptable in the past is not acceptable anymore to more and more people as we get conscious. So think about it, slavery. Slavery was the law of the land in the United States and many other countries 150 years ago. The US fought a brutal war to end it, civil war. Many other countries did away with it. But slavery has been a part of human history from the beginning. Every civilization, the Romans, the Greeks, the Indians, the Chinese, everywhere there was slavery. Now you cannot imagine slavery, right? Existing in human society. 100 years ago, women did not have the right to vote. Even in democracies, New Zealand was the lone exception. The US was 1920. The US democracy is less than 100 years old. Women did not have the right to vote. Switzerland, there are parts of Switzerland that women did not have the right to vote fully until the late 80s or early 90s. And now Switzerland has a female majority government. Okay? Things are changing. 75 years ago, we had colonialism. India was still a British colony 70 years ago, right? That's another form of slavery. That's gone. 50 years ago in the US, there was segregation, blacks and whites, separated. 30 years ago, there was apartheid in South Africa. 15 years ago, there were no gay rights for gay people. So in the US, no gay marriage, etc. Again, these are all barriers that are falling. We are waking up and having a finer sense of right and wrong, what is acceptable, what is not. We're also becoming more peaceful. We are living in the most peaceful time in human history. Did you realize that? There's a wonderful book on Better Angels of Our Nature by Steven Pinker. He's a Harvard professor. He's got the data from thousands of years. Violence is down 99% compared to historic norms. He has 3 or 4 TED Talks. Okay, you can get all of that through those many TED Talks. Fewer people have been killed in wars, by far. No major nations have gone to war with each other since World War II. Fewer people are being killed by murderers, by terrorists. Even on highways, there are fewer deaths. You know, when I moved to the US, 1980s in New York City, 4,000 murders a year. Last year, 380 murders. 90% decline. Okay, 30 years in the murder rate. That's true across many US cities. There's less domestic violence in homes. There's less violence in schools. There's less bullying. Rapes are down compared to historic norms. Every indicator of violent crime is down, and violence is down. Human beings are rising above violence. Resorting to violence is an animalistic response. It doesn't solve anything. More and more of us are realizing that. But we don't realize that because we think there's no violence, right? Every day there's a new horrible story. But the numbers don't add up. So as Bill Clinton said, don't mistake the headlines for the trend lines. Okay? The headline screams one thing, the trend line may be in the opposite direction. We have to know the actual data, not what is considered news. We're becoming more inclusive, we're learning to live in harmony with nature. Again, these are all indicators of our rising consciousness. So a lot has changed. And as Abraham Lincoln said, the dogmas of the quiet past are inadequate to the stormy present. As our cases view, we must think anew and act anew. And he said this after the Civil War. I think what has changed today is far more. It's far truer today. Just what everything you thought you knew was wrong. You have to re-examine every assumption. Rethink everything. Because the world has changed, people have changed. We cannot continue business as usual. In any sphere, government, education, but certainly in the world of business, we have to rethink the whole thing. What will it take for companies now to be agents of flourishing? I'll give you a very, very quick example to illustrate the principles here. So Whole Foods is a company, it's the biggest natural and organic foods retailer in the world. Started in 1978 in Austin, Texas. Under the name of Safeway. Why Safeway? Because there's a large grocery chain in the US called Safeway. But they are saying, no, there's a better way to eat. You don't need to put all the artificial ingredients and the colors and the pesticides and preservatives and so forth. That it matters what you put into your body. It matters to your health, the health of the food system, and the health of the planet. All of that is impacted by our choices when it comes to food. So their purpose is to educate people and to give them access to better food, healthier food. To improve their health and their longevity, how long they live and how well they live. That's their purpose. So they have a higher purpose, a reason for being that goes beyond making money. They make money so they can achieve their purpose. They don't, you know, try to fulfill a purpose so they can make money. It's a big difference. They try to be profitable and they're highly profitable. You can see at the bottom 2,000% returns to investors. But the reason for doing that is so that they can achieve their purpose and bring them to their scale. So that's one idea. The second is the idea of interdependence. They recognize that all the stakeholders are connected together. The well-being of employees and customers and suppliers is all related to each other. So they illustrate the pillars of conscious capitalism, which are 4 simple ideas, but they run counter to traditional business thinking. First of all, every business needs a higher purpose other than profit. So profit is not the purpose. You have to, just like for each of you in this room, hopefully, your purpose is not just to make as much money as possible and then die. Your purpose is to do something with your life, this precious gift that you have. Every organization should have its own purpose. Every business should have a purpose. Secondly, it's not just about shareholders, it is about stakeholders. And it's about integrating the interests of all stakeholders together. So what is good for one is good for all. It's about creating a win-win-win-win across all stakeholders rather than trading them off. Leadership. It's not about using people to achieve your goals. It's about serving people. Creating a vision, taking them to a better place. Conscious leaders are not about command and control. Carrots and sticks, they're about elevating people, inspiring people, celebrating people. And cultures, which are not rooted in fear and stress, and performance above all, but actually rooted in trust and care and accountability. So it answers all the questions of what, why, who, where, and so what, why, who, and how. And also for each of these, very quickly I'll offer a shorthand or an acronym that captures the essence of that idea. So starting with purpose. I believe every great purpose needs to be a healing purpose. Because we live in a world of extraordinary suffering. There is so much pain and suffering in this world every day that we can't even comprehend it. And if we are not consciously trying to be part of the healing, we are probably unconsciously part of the hurting. And too many businesses and too many organizations are actually adding to people's suffering in some way while they're trying to make money or whatever. So healing is the most noble calling of all. Alleviate suffering and bring more joy to the world through whatever it is that we do. We can do it through food, we can do it through travel, we can do it through whatever. Doesn't matter what business is, it can still be an instrument of reducing suffering and bringing more joy. It also stands for the qualities of a great purpose. And we don't have time to go into all of these, but you know, it's heroic. It's trying to change the world for the better. It evolves over time. It aligns all stakeholders together, so literally they are not at cross purposes. Because when you are just about profit maximization, as your purpose, and every stakeholder has the same purpose. Customers want to maximize their profit. Employees want to maximize their profit, which means workers don't get paid as much. Suppliers want to maximize. Society wants to tax you as much as possible. Right? Because why? You're saying you're going to take as much money as possible, so everybody becomes a taker from the system. In any system where everybody is a taker, sooner or later that system will lead to death. In this system, everybody is a giver. You have to believe in what you are about. In order to win, 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 you have to give, give, give. Because all you do is take. I think that is. The more you give, the more you receive from that system. It flourishes. It's rooted in love, it's inspiring, it's natural, and it's galvanizing. Moves you to action. Okay, quick example, Google, highly purpose-driven company from day one. They organize the world's information, make it easily accessible and useful. That has given them extraordinary relevance and opportunities for growth. REI, Recreational Equipment Inc., reconnect people with nature. Our kids are spending 52 hours a week in front of a screen of some kind and only 20 minutes in nature. That's the USA. Their whole purpose is get people reconnected to nature. It's something unnatural about how we live. Facebook. Extraordinary growth, rooted in their purpose, make the world more open and connected, and they have really made a difference in people's lives in that regard. Okay, very quickly, the second pillar is stakeholders, and here the acronym is SPICE. In the US, I joke, why SPICE? Well, because I'm from India, everything has to have spice, right? What is life without spice? And we added E for the environment, but it really stands for the stakeholders in the right order. Society must come first. You have to be on the right side of society. You have to find the solution for society, not part of the problem. Partners, investors, customers, employees, for each of them, there's an unconscious way of thinking. Represented at the top, there's a conscious way of thinking about creating value. For consciously for each stakeholder. Not just using them as a means to create value for shareholders. But actually consciously saying, how can I make my employees' lives better? How can I make their children's lives better? How can I make my communities better? How can I treat my suppliers as customers? And make sure that they are thriving. Make sure that everybody else is thriving. If you do that, cooperation also will thrive, because these are all elements connected to the cooperation. And when you do this, it becomes a virtuous cycle. Again, we won't go into the details of this, but you know, you have a purpose, you hire people who passionately care about that, for whom that is their own calling, treat them well, they're innovative, they're caring. Suppliers the same way, customers are happy, loyal, right? The profits are high, shareholders are happy, with resources you can invest in the community and causes that are aligned to your business. I mean, it really keeps going. But remember, it's like a clock. It only works clockwise. That's a worry. If I say we're going to focus on making money, and when we do, we're going to give bonuses, and we're going to donate money to charities, and we're going to do all kinds of... Focus on creating value before you start spending that money. Do the things that create value in the first place. It means doing all the same things. Okay, very quickly on leadership. Swamiji said, we must be the change you wish to see in the world. You cannot have a conscious company without a conscious leader. You cannot be a conscious leader unless you're a conscious human being. So we work on ourselves to become more conscious, more awakened, more mindful. And leadership matters today as much as it ever did. Even though people are smart and they're connected and they're caring and they're conscious, all of that, still we need leadership. What is Peter Drucker said, only three things happen naturally in organizations: friction, confusion, and underperformance. Everything else takes leadership. You can put the most brilliant people. You can take the most brilliant, well-being people, put them together, come back a few hours later, you'll find friction, confusion, and underperformance. Until somebody steps into the awesome responsibility of leadership, which is clear vision for where we're trying to go and how we're going to get there. Somebody needs to do that. Leadership matters. Great deal. And it has to be the right kind of leadership. So the acronym here, very appropriately, is selfless. A great leader, a conscious leader, has to be selfless. You cannot be selfish and be a leader. Because a person who uses other people to achieve their goals is not a leader, that is a tyrant. A tyrant uses other people to achieve their personal objectives. A true leader helps people get to their place. They have transcended the self. They are not only self-actualized, they are self-transcended. Not about me. And it stands for the qualities which you can see again. Combination of masculine and feminine strength and love. The greatest leaders. I mean, think about Gandhi and Lincoln and Mandela and King. They are tremendously strong, rooted in caring. The leaders who are only about strength almost destroyed human civilization. Hitler and Mao and Stalin and others. It also has emotional intelligence, systems intelligence, and spiritual intelligence. Now these are all things that can be grown and cultivated. Unlike IQ, which is fixed. Right? We can actually become more conscious leaders if we focus on our development. A summary phrase to capture this is that as leaders we must be the wise fools of tough love. You have to be wise, represent that higher self, and childlike, be playful. Again, I think about Gandhiji and Nelson Mandela and the Dalai Lama. Tremendous wisdom and tremendous humor. Lightness of being, right? Be a wise fool of tough love. Be able to be tough when needed, the masculine side, but also loving. You have to embody all of this in one entity. You have to become a whole person. You have to integrate masculine, feminine, higher self, child self. And then you have to know, in a given situation, I have to show more toughness or more wisdom or more lightness or more caring, whatever it might be. As Martin Luther King said, we must be tough-minded and tender-hearted at the same time. Okay, last element here is culture, and we wrap up. You know, culture is something You don't spend a lot of time on it in business school, it's not the most important thing. There's no company in the world that MBA students don't know the strategy. Strategy is not a secret. Okay? But culture is really what makes the difference. As Rato said, culture is strategy for lunch. You don't think it breaks up to lunch. Culture is incredibly important. How we do things, how we treat each other, what's the atmosphere? And the phrase I use here is tactile. I walk into a conscious business, I can feel the difference. The energy, the optimism, the enthusiasm, the actual caring, it shows up. You walk into Google's headquarters, or you walk into Southwest Airlines Flight, or to Patagonia, or many of these conscious companies. I would say Tata is a highly conscious company in India, sorry. It stands for these qualities, it's tactile. So I will focus on this word caring for the last part here. The key element here, if I have to talk about what is the biggest single difference between conscious capitalism and traditional, is that this integrates caring. It's not just about self-interest, it's also about caring. Can businesses be built on that care? That was a question that was asked by Whole Foods when they started. Most businesses are run on fear and stress. I would say most organizations, most governments, even many nonprofits run on fear and stress. That's, we think we have to motivate people. Right? By using carrots and sticks. What animal belongs between a carrot and a stick? It's a donkey. It's not a human being. That metaphor is what we use to motivate human beings. It creates fear and stress. So I may have this thing in the, I don't know if it's in India, and last Friday, the restaurant chain? Right? I used to ask my American friends, I said, I thought you go to church on Sunday. Like, why are you thanking God on Friday? And I was joking, of course. They said, don't you get it? We survive another hellish week at work, which means now we get to party, we get drunk. And then we do it again on Saturday, and Sunday comes around, and then what? Here we go again, right? So I was at a conference with the Dalai Lama, said, heart attacks are highest on Monday morning. I don't know why everybody laughs. It's a sad statistic, okay? But it's true. Look it up. 20% higher. Our work is literally killing us. Murderers, terrorists, wars are not. Our work is the biggest killer out there. Okay? Stress is the biggest killer. 75% of healthcare is chronic disease. Most of that is stress related. Most of that is work related. Employee engagement. I'm sure you're familiar with Gallup's way of measuring this. So, in the US, only 30% of employees are engaged, 50% are disengaged, so 30% care about their work, 50% don't care, right? And 20% hate it. They hate their work, they hate their co-workers, they hate the company. It's like you have a boat and 10 people are supposed to be rowing, only 3 are actually rowing, 5 are pretending, and 2 are hitting other people over the head with their paddles. That's the typical state of affairs, and that's the highest in the world. The United States has the highest employee engagement. Worldwide, it's only 13%. In India, it's only 9% of people in India who have a job are engaged in that job. 91% are not engaged. Just think about that. It's not only an economic loss. It is an extraordinary waste of a precious human life to go through life not having passion and purpose to your work. You know, we only have 100,000 hours to work in our lifetime. Work is inherently meaningful to human beings. In fact, as Freud said, love and work are the cornerstones of our humanness. What we ask is, why can we not combine these two? Why can we not love what we do and love the people we work with and love the people we serve? Why can't love be part of the world of work? Why do we have to leave our humanity at home? Why do we have to put on a mask and armor to go to work? Because it's a kind of battle for most people. That really has been the root of my work in the last 10 years, my research, and my books. Starting with this book in 2007, firms of India, companies that are loved by all their stakeholders. Customers love them, employees love them, communities love them, suppliers love them. And I was trying to understand how and why. How can that happen? People use these kinds of words to describe that. We did a second edition in 2014 with more data and more companies. And we did a financial analysis at the end of all of that. And here's what we found. We didn't select these companies based on financial performance, but what we found at the end, having selected them for purpose and stakeholder leadership and culture, is that they actually outperformed, even though they're paying their people better, paying their suppliers better, treating their customers better, investing in their communities, investing in the environment, paying taxes at a higher rate, and still they have more money left over for investors. We said, how is this possible? Are they printing money in the basement? No. They are creating extraordinary value. They're aligning everybody together in a shared purpose. And they're rooted in caring and trust. 14 to 1 outperformance over a 15-year period. It was 9 to 1 over 10 years of the original work. So this led us to ask the question that, wow, what's happening here? How are they doing it? These are very, very profitable companies. They make money, and a profit is a social good. In conscious capitalism, we believe in profit. Why? Because without profit, we don't have taxes. And without taxes, we don't have infrastructure, we don't have public schools, we don't have public housing. Governments need businesses to generate profit. That wealth, financial wealth, is important for society. So profits are important, but it matters how you make the money. It matters a great deal how we generate those profits, right? Because businesses create, but we also destroy wealth eventually. It's not just financial, it's intellectual capital. Innovations, breakthroughs. It's social capital, trust and cohesion in society. It's emotional well-being, operating in love and care versus fear and stress. It's spiritual well-being, having meaning and purpose in your life through your work. Impact on the culture, what defines a good life. Impact on our bodies, impact on the environment. All of those are the consequences of how we do business. And a traditional business will say we're all about making money and everything else is a side effect. As you know, side effects tend to be negative. Well, I'm sorry, there's no such thing on this planet called a side effect. You do things, and there are effects. All the effects matter. Just if you, because you put it in fine print or you say it fast, doesn't make it as important. There's no such thing called a side effect. There are just effects. And can we do business with a spectrum of positive effects? It can be done if you have the intention and desire to do so. It does exist, so it must be possible. This captures some of the complacency that we've had in the past. I think that is not our problem, right? Some people are suffering greatly, other people are okay, high and dry. The reality is that we are all connected. We are all in the same boat. This planet is one system, okay? Humanity is connected. You know, America sends their manufacturing to China and places like that, right? And the air and water quality is really good in the US, relatively compared to. And then we read about Chinese cities where, in India has lots of those too, right? The air is so bad, people are turned on gas masks. And rivers that are so polluted, you can't use the water even for industrial cooling. People say, well, I don't want that to be the consequence of our consumption. But then you read about clouds floating over California full of poisonous gases. And it says made in China. It's showing up all over the US. We didn't know all of that. It's all one system. Okay? We are interconnected, interdependent. One more point I really want to make is, you know, this idea of entrepreneurship is also actually closely related to this problem of terrorism. I would say entrepreneurs and terrorists are two sides of the same coin. Young people who have no opportunity, no future. 50-60% unemployment, especially in the Middle East, may cause a great impact. If there's no future, you turn towards other ideologies. So it's a form of entrepreneurialism, right? Trying to achieve something. It makes it all the more important that we create opportunities, economic opportunities, including the climate or culture of entrepreneurship in society. So to conclude, humanity is one spirit. We're all interconnected, we're all interdependent. Each other. We're starting to know that and feel that on a global level more than before. Our natural resources are finite. We are running out of some of them. But what is not limited on this planet, what is unlimited is what society can be, human capacities. are unlimited. Even creativity is unlimited. Now, I used to do work with Bosco. I know Bosco has a history in this state, but I visited their plant in Pohang in Korea. And I highly admired nothing in case. And at the entrance to their plant, it says, resources are limited, creativity is unlimited. There is no limit to human creativity. Human beings are capable of extraordinary, almost divine things. And conditions have to be right. The most powerful source of renewable energy on this planet is human beings. I mean, even this term human resources, we should do away with that. What is a human resource? The resource is like a lump of coal. What happens when you use it? It's gone. Human beings are not a resource. Human beings are a source. It's like the sun. Generating light and warmth, energy, caring, compassion, creativity, innovation. Human beings are capable of that, an extraordinary energy. But the condition has to be right. It's like the seed and the soil. The human seed has never been more powerful. Human beings, as I said, are more intelligent, more informed, more caring, more compassionate, more awakened. All of that. The seed is extraordinary, but the soil remains toxic. You can take the greatest seed in the world. If you put it in soil that is toxic, it will not amount to anything. The soil is the culture. It's the purpose. It's the leadership. We're in charge of the soil. Create the conditions and just then watch what human beings flourish into, what they bring to bear. I have one more slide if I can get to it. So to conclude, those of us who are alive today can choose to lead the most meaningful lives human beings have ever led on this planet. Now that's saying a lot. The fact is that our challenges are greater than ever. We have crises seemingly on many, many fronts, whether it's water or climate change or energy or so many things, running out of resources. Our challenges are greater than ever, but so is our awareness and consciousness of those challenges. And our ability to do something about it has never been greater. We have billions of people who are now capable of being part of the solution. But it won't happen if we continue to operate in the old way, where we treat people as objects and use them, where we create organizations that are rooted only in profit. We need to build an organization rooted in higher purpose and characterized by love and care. And you'll see human beings rise to extraordinary heights. So thank you for your patience and thank you for having me here today. I really appreciate your time and your attention. And I'm happy to answer any questions. Thank you.